Alaska. Even today, the word sets the imagination of the world ablaze. It is the land of the midnight sun, where Eskimos eat blubber and polar bear prowl windswept sheets of the polar ice pack. Here, glaciers calve into ice flow-choked sounds, where walrus bellow and orca cruise the depths in search of king salmon and seal pups, while overhead, the aurora borealis dances from horizon to horizon across the winter sky. But it is more than that. It is the land of the Alaska Gold Rush, where nuggets were said to be the size of goose eggs, where men froze to death in search of the elusive yellow metal, and dance hall girls lured drunk, overnight millionaires into marriage. Honky-tonk pianos punctuated the howl of the north wind in towns that were half-tent and half-ramshackle collections of driftwood, whalebone, and packing cases. It was a time of whiskey and gold and long, lonely trails behind a dog sled. It was, in a word, Alaska. In truth, the Alaska Gold Rush was all of that. It was a riotous time with saints and scoundrels living side by side. In the cities, rugged men and women walked on planks set across streets so deep with spring mud that horses could be swallowed. On the tundra, life became a living hell with mosquitoes, gnats, white sox, and biting flies that descended on warm-blooded creatures in clouds. On the flip side of the seasons, the temperature could drop to 50 or 60 degrees below zero, cold enough to freeze a can of motor oil so solid it could be cut in half with a saw. With the wind blasting at 100 miles an hour, the chill factor could go well below 100 degrees below zero, cold enough to freeze a person to death in a matter of minutes if he could not find proper shelter. In whiteout conditions, visibility could be cut to a foot in a matter of minutes. Then there was the gold. Unending rivers of it from dust to nuggets so heavy they would rip out the seams of your pockets. It could be panned out of beach sand, dug out of the ground, plucked from quartz veins deep in mining tunnels, or found just lying around in a stream bed. There was enough to build an empire. Juno alone took 5 times more gold out of the Treadwell and Alaska Juno mines than the United States paid for all of Alaska. And that was 20 years before the booms in Nome and Fairbanks, or the hundreds of other strikes that stretched from the Arctic Ocean to the Inside Passage. Besides the gold, there was the adventure of it all, for this was Alaska, a land where anything was possible. And so they came by the thousands. They were called Argonauts, like the famous men of Jason's men who went in search of the Golden Fleece in the annals of Greek mythology. In 1898, the Argonauts lived again, but in this era, seeking gold in the form of dust and nuggets and bullion. Not a lot of Argonauts became wealthy, but every person that was touched by the spell of Alaska was changed forever. Each took a bit of the North home with them to Des Moines and Paris and Tokyo and 1,000 other cities and towns. Around the world, Alaska became the byword for adventure, where dreams could come true and wealth was in the reach of the common man. To this day, travelers from the four corners of the earth still flood to Alaska, believing that as they walk the streets of Juneau, Nome, and Fairbanks, they can still hear the ghostly honky-tonk of the saloon pianos echoing across a century, drawing them back to the wild and woolly days when the very word Alaska set the imagination of the world ablaze. In actuality, the Alaska Gold Rush is many stories. While no tape, let alone any book, can cover the entire scope of the rush, this presentation will cover the highlights of the era, including a discussion of the three largest strikes, Juneau, Fairbanks, and Nome, as well as the disastrous stampedes at Valdez and Kotzebue. And along the way, there will be some social history to put a human face on the Alaska Gold Rush. While there is a solid date for the end of the Alaska Gold Rush, April 8, 1944, when the Alaska Juneau mine in Juneau closed permanently, there is no real starting date. Gold had been found in the Nome area by Americans as early as 1866, but those men were more interested in staying alive than digging in the permafrost for the yellow metal. The first sizable strike in Alaska came in 1880 when Chief Cowie of the Auk Indians, who lived outside of what is now Juneau, went to George Pills, a prospector in Sitka. Pills, a German metallurgist, was paying Indians 100 blankets if they could lead him to a gold strike. Cowie was interested in the blankets, but he had come at a bad time. His best men were out looking at prospects, and the only people he could send were the dregs of his organization, a drunk by the name Richard T. Harris and an illiterate named Joe Juno. These unlikely partners took a small boat to the present site of Juno, quickly traded their food and supplies for rot-gut booze from a nearby Indian fishing camp, and spent the next 3 weeks on a drunken binge. They returned to Sitka and told Pills that there was no gold. But Cowie, who had returned to Sitka on his own, emphatically told Pills that his two men hadn't so much as gotten off the beach, much less sampled the creek where Cowie knew there was gold. Pills was outraged. He ordered Juno and Harris back under notice that if they didn't look precisely where Chief Cowie instructed them, they would not be paid. When they went back the second time, the two sots discovered what turned out to be the richest gold find in Alaskan history. But the rise of Juno is not the saga of a solitary prospector searching for nuggets in an ice-cold mountain stream. Rather, it is the story of large mining companies who dominated the history of that community. The gold in Juno was in the hard rock of the mountains, and the only way to retrieve it was to bore tunnels into the very heart of them. Hundreds of miners spent their lives underground following the elusive veins wherever they led. Over six decades, the Juno mines produced $2.3 billion in today's dollars. And today, Juno lives comfortably on that legacy. It is a sedate, cultured community with a population of about 30,000. The gold industry has long since abandoned the area, and another has taken its place. Now, instead of plucking nuggets from the veins in Mount Juno, the residents of Alaska's capital city extract money from the wallets of tourists. At the most, Juno only saw about $36 million a year during the height of the Alaska gold rush. Today, the city sees more than three times that each year mining the tourists. The tourists come north to see the land of the gold rush, and the tourism industry mines the tourists, so you can see that the Alaska gold rush is not yet dead in Juno. Historically, by the time of the Klondike Rush in 1898, Juno was a well-established city. It had an operating court system and was a regular stop on the steamship line. For many tourists at the turn of the last century, Juno was Alaska, and that did not change until gold was discovered in the Klondike. The first real indication that there was gold in the north came on July 17, 1897, when the steamer Portland landed in Seattle with what the newspapers reported was a ton of gold on board. The wharf was mobbed with people who watched awestruck as bearded sourdoughs sauntered down the gangplank laden with the golden ore. "Show us your gold," the crowd cried, and many of the miners did. Within a matter of hours, Klondike fever swept Seattle. By the end of the week, it had swept the West Coast, and by the end of the month, everyone was talking of nothing but the Yukon Territory and gold, gold, gold. This was the start of the Klondike Gold Rush, the strike that was to draw the likes of Jack London and Robert Service, though Robert Service didn't actually get to Dawson until it was a ghost town. The heart of the strike was the city of Dawson, at the confluence of the Klondike and Yukon rivers. For 18 months, this was the center of attention for the world, with 100,000 men and quite a few women rushing north as fast as they could go by whatever means was at hand. But getting to Dawson was an arduous task for most Argonauts. For Americans, it meant getting to a West Coast city to take a steamship north. This meant getting to Seattle or Portland, but San Francisco or Los Angeles would do. Then there was the matter of gathering the necessities of surviving in the Yukon. Correctly fearing the prospect of having tens of thousands of starving men gunning each other down for a mouthful of food during the winter, the Canadian government required 1,000 pounds of food for every man who crossed the border. This was in addition to the gold mining equipment, so it didn't take long for the poundage to add up. For a syndicate of four men, 6,000 pounds of equipment was not unusual. While it was not difficult moving these 3 tons of supplies by rail to the West Coast or by steamship to Skagway or Dyea, once the men got off the steamer, they had to travel by foot, and every ounce became a concern. But there was reason to be concerned long before any Argonaut ever arrived in Skagway or Dyea. With so many stampeders trying to get north, there was a staggering demand for transportation. This, in turn, led to a large number of unscrupulous men putting together steamship companies whose sole asset was one or two steamers which had been pulled out of a salvage yard or off a beach where it had been washed ashore decades earlier. With a fresh coat of paint, a few timbers, and a lot of crossed fingers, these ships were offered to the Argonauts as seaworthy ships. But just as quickly as they went to sea, they came apart. Many sank. Those that survived made the voyage so hazardous, not to mention unpleasant, that horror stories of the sea voyage north were commonplace. Many of the ships reeked of the smell of their previous career, and it was impossible to spend much time below decks. Other passengers wrote of ships so decrepit that caulking could actually be pulled out from between the hull timbers. But this was not even half the problem. These ships were overloaded to the point that many of them turned turtle or flipped over. Every cubic inch below decks was filled with cargo, often with no thought of how the ship would be balanced. Horses, pigs, and dogs were jammed in what space remained. Sometimes there was so much cargo that it was just piled on deck and tied down with ropes. Cargo doors were jammed open with luggage that made every storm potentially fatal. Then, after the cargo and animals had been stowed, the passengers were overbooked. Ships that normally were allowed 30 passengers booked 150. Bunk rooms were built wherever there was room and men slept in rotation. They ate in rotation as well, sometimes waiting for hours to get a meal. The galleys had to run almost around the clock to feed the passengers, and even then the food was more gruel than a meal. The epitome of overloading was the Alki, which left Seattle on July 19, 1898. The ship carried 110 passengers, 900 sheep, 65 cattle, 30 horses, and still managed to load 350 tons of supplies. Another dilapidated wreck, the Colorado, left Seattle with 350 horses, 150 cattle, and 100 dogs. Once aboard, these animals had to be fed and watered daily, a chore that fell to their owners. The combined smell of animals, flatulence, manure, and feed in these ocean-going stables added to the onboard stench. Dead animals were not uncommon, and extracting their cadavers was a chore worthy of Hercules. Then there were the crews, or what passed for crews. When hundreds of seasoned sailors abandoned decks for the gold fields, men whose maritime experience was limited to rowboats on calm country lakes often filled their places. Unscrupulous men claimed years of sea experience to get a free ride north. Farmers, bartenders, card sharks, and derelicts signed on as seamen, many of them so unfamiliar with the ocean they were unsure what their job entailed. When manpower became tight, men were shanghaied. Fighting was not uncommon and drunkenness a hazard to the safety of the ship. That any ship managed to arrive in Skagway and Dyea at all is amazing. That many did not is not surprising. More than 50 ships went down in 1898, the first year of the stampede. One of the strangest was the Clara Nevada, Alaska's ghost ship. On her maiden voyage, the Clara Nevada went down on the night of February 5, 1898, near Eldred Rock, midway between Juneau and Skagway. The ship was on her return trip to Skagway, headed south, with as many as 165 passengers and at least 11,000 ounces of gold, $4 million in today's dollars. The ship sank under mysterious circumstances. But what makes the Clara Nevada so noteworthy is that 10 years later, almost to the day, she resurfaced, the bones of her dead littering the shore of Eldred Rock. While it is certainly true that many ships have gone to the bottom of the sea, very few have resurfaced, whatever the reason. Of note to treasure hunters, the 11,000 ounces of gold on board the Clara Nevada has never been found. Arriving in Skagway or Dyea, the Argonauts were still not out of danger. While they had faced the raw fury of Mother Nature, now they had to contend with the wickedness of man. Skagway was run by the notorious Jefferson Randolph Smith, also known as Soapy Smith, a con man and gang leader who sought to rob as many stampeders as he and his gang possibly could. They tried mightily, but they could not rob them all. But they scammed quite a few. In addition to crooked card games, loaded dice, fake fundraising efforts, and hoodwinks of every variety, they ran rampant over law and order. Murder was a common affair, and between February and July of 1898, the Royal Canadian Mounted Police estimated there was a murder a day. One stampeder noted with gallows humor that doctors would not thrive well in Skagway. For there are but four burials in the cemetery, and I have not heard of anyone being sick. In Skagway, people didn't get sick. They got shot. The reign of Soapy Smith did not last long. In July of 1898, his gang robbed one too many prospectors, and a sleeping vigilante movement sprang to life. Meeting at the end of a Skagway pier, the forces of law and order were debating what to do when Soapy made the mistake of approaching the group with a loaded Winchester. An altercation ensued in which Soapy was killed instantly. With their leader gone, the gang was quickly rounded up and sent to Sitka for trial. While the focus of the Seattle newspapers was on Skagway, most of the attention of the Argonauts was on Dyea, the head of the Chilkoot Trail. This was the preferred route into Canada. Though it was steeper, the Chilkoot Pass was a shorter route into Canada than the White Pass out of Skagway. In fact, the Chilkoot Pass is probably the best known and most identifiable aspect of the Klondike Gold Rush, with men walking up the ice staircase in a long line at a place named the Scales, so named because of a generation of tramways located here which had charged by the pound. The trail rose 1,000 feet in 2 miles. At the top was Canada. Though this trail was tougher, the walk was shorter, and this was the key to speed when it came to getting to the Klondike. For most of the men, the journey from Dyea to Lake Lindeman would be on foot, continuous trips of 50 to 75 pounds per man. Moving forward was strictly a job for the fit. A man would load up, walk a few miles, and deposit or cash his load. Then he would return for another 75 pounds. This process would continue ad nauseam until the entire 1,500 pounds, his portion of the syndicate's supplies, had been moved forward a few miles. Then the process would start all over again. Each man had to pack a total of 59 miles to move all his food and supplies forward a single mile. If it was during the summer, the packers had to contend with deep mud on the trail and the clouds of mosquitoes and biting flies that swarmed them. During winter, blizzards could bury their cache in a matter of an hour. Time was lost on bad weather, avalanches, blockage on the trail, weighing food at the Canadian border, seas of mud, and traveling only as fast as the slowest member of the syndicate. The shortest route to the top of the Chilkoot Pass was straight up the slope. While there was a tram, many of the Argonauts could not afford the rate, or preferred not to pay it, and carried their own cargo, 70 pounds at a time, up the 1,200 ice stairs. The men stood in line, shoulder to shoulder, for hours, waiting for their chance to ascend the narrow staircase. With everything from needle and thread to pieces of a boat, the men ascended the 30-degree ice walkway, step by step by step, going the speed of the slowest man ahead of them. There are quite a few myths which cling to the staircase. One of them is that there were so many men moving up the stairs that if one stepped out of line, he might have to wait for hours to rejoin the rush. This is not true. Businessmen who saw the value in charging each man who used their facility had constructed the staircase. Since every syndicate was moving at the rate of 50 to 70 pounds per man per trip, each person would have to make multiple trips. That, in turn, meant multiple fees to use the staircase. The men that built and maintained the staircase had every incentive to make sure the men didn't get what were called cold feet and go home. The men who stepped off the staircase were known as cold footers, and from this comes the expression to get cold feet, meaning to become frightened and quit a project that was underway. To keep the Argonauts from getting cold feet, the staircase was made as functional and therefore profitable as possible. A rope handrail ran to the top of the Chilkoot Pass, and every 20 or 30 steps, there was a level area where the Argonauts could step out of line for a rest. Those wily entrepreneurs were so successful that there is even a report of a peg-leg man making it over the Chilkoot. Don't forget that all the men you see walking up the ice staircase of the Chilkoot Pass had to come back down to get more supplies and gear. While going up was difficult, coming down for the next load was a breeze. It was simply a matter of sliding down what became known as the Grease Trail, a shoulder-deep channel that had been worn smooth by men sliding to the bottom, as one stampeder recalled, on a gee pole, a spade, or a bit of canvas. Since the Grease Trail was so narrow, each Argonaut had to time the men ahead of them. If someone got hung up in the trail, it might mean a dangerous pileup in the snow channel. But the wild and woolly days of the Chilkoot Pass were fleeting. As men were lockstepping their way up the ice staircase, a railroad was being built over the White Pass out of Skagway. The completion of that railway, the White Pass and Yukon Railroad, came on July 29, 1900, and the face of the Northland changed forever. Before the railroad, the only way into the gold country was on foot, and it took a special breed of person to be willing to submit himself to the rigors of the trail, the mosquitoes, and mud in the summer and ice fog in the winter, moving forward at the rate of 2 or 3 miles a week, and then facing the terrors of white water travel in frail, overloaded, undependable, handmade boats. It had been a culling process, with the weak quitting and selling their goods along the trail or simply abandoning the cargo where it sat. The railroad changed all that. After July 29, 1900, it was possible for a stampeder to place his 1,500-pound load on the train and ride all the way to Whitehorse in a single day. Dai died that day, and Skagway saw a new birth. But it wasn't to last long. The news of a new strike in Nome on the coast of the Bering Sea was already drawing men out of Dawson and Whitehorse by the boatload. By the end of 1900, the White Pass and Yukon Railroad would be nothing more than a metal ribbon connecting two towns shrinking in population as fast as they had grown the previous year. But before the Klondike strike was concluded, it created one of the greatest disasters of the century, the Valdez Stampede. To have called the Valdez Stampede a disaster is like calling the Vietnam War an incident. 3,000 stampeders rushed into Valdez on their way to Dawson, though the logic of this is hard to understand today. How many died is unknown, but the destitute numbered well over 1,000, men who had tried to cross the treacherous Valdez Glacier lured by the promise of gold the size of goose eggs. Instead, they found starvation, destitution, and death. The disaster began when unscrupulous steamboat companies convinced stampeders that there was another way to get to Dawson, a way that would avoid the congestion at the Chilkoot Pass. This was the so-called All-American Route because almost the entire trail was through American territory. It started in Valdez on Prince William Sound and went along the spine of the Valdez Glacier and then up the Copper River watershed. Then it went over a few mountain ranges and dropped into Dawson. And, of course, if someone were to find gold in the Copper River watershed, well, then there would be no reason to continue on to the Klondike. Thus, in the fall of 1898, 3,000 Argonauts, none of whom had a map as to the country they were entering, left Valdez and slowly began making their way across the glacier. Since they were on ice, it made sense to move their cargo by sled. Each was loaded with around 200 pounds of cargo and moved several miles at a time. Back and forth the men went, 200 pounds per load, until all the food and gear for the syndicate had been moved forward. Then the process would start again. It was not easy work, as stampeder George Hazlett learned when he began moving his supplies over the glacier. After pulling two 200-pound sleds a day, every day for weeks, he wrote that he had referred to himself as a beast of burden with long, floppy ears like a donkey. The route was torturous. The sun beat down on the stampeders and cooked their flesh. Rain created floods that washed away their camps. Snow froze them, the wind whipped them, and accidents dwindled their ranks. Then, cruelest of all, when they arrived in the Copper River watershed, they found no gold at all. The rush over the glacier had been a fraud, a scam to make money for the shipping companies. Exhausted, many of them starving, hundreds stumbled back over the glacier to Valdez. No one knows how many died on the way, but the number could approach 1,000. Those that were lucky enough to make it back found the city teeming with the destitute, packed like sardines in abandoned cabins, frostbitten and living in a stench that was indescribable. They would have died in that condition had not the United States Army under the command of Captain William Randolph Abercrombie come to their rescue. Abercrombie convinced the steamships to take the destitute back to Seattle at half the price of a ticket and then hired those who were able to work as manual laborers on what is now the Richardson Highway. The destitute were paid $1 a day plus board and were kept on payroll for 32 days, just long enough to enable them to pay for a ticket to Seattle and to leave them with $5 when they arrived. Further north, a similar disaster was being played out the same year. Again, sparked by unscrupulous steamship companies who were only interested in selling tickets north, they started a rumor that there was gold enough for every man on the Kobuk River. Once again, without a map or any idea where to look for the yellow metal, several thousand men rushed north through the Bering Sea for Kotzebue Sound. But the Kotzebue rush was different because the Bering Sea and the Kobuk River are only ice-free for a few months each. A very few months. There were only about 120 days of ice-free travel. If you could not get into your claim and back out before the ice covered the river and ocean, you were stuck until the next spring. Many of the Argonauts did not understand this and found themselves ill-prepared for the long and ferocious winter of 1898. Hundreds of them ran out of food before spring and tried to walk out through a winter wasteland where temperatures fell to 50 below zero with regularity. Some tried to walk to the new settlement of Nome, 183 miles to the west, and never arrived. Others tried to make it over the mountains into the Koyukuk River Basin, where there were rumored to be settlements. Hundreds more died on the slopes of the mountain range. The next spring, the Revenue Cutter Service, the forerunner of the United States Coast Guard, had to rescue more than 70 destitute miners on the beach of Kotzebue. How many froze to death or died of starvation on the merciless landscape of the Arctic will never be known, but some sources estimate the dead were as high as 1,200, almost half the people who went in, and a significant number of these were women. When it comes to the Alaska Gold Rush, perhaps the best-known strike was at Nome on the shores of the Bering Sea. Ironically, the discovery of gold in Nome was by accident. Perhaps the man most responsible for the Nome strike was an Englishman who never made it to the Northland and died 6 years before the Alaska Gold Rush set the world ablaze. Further, it was the failure of this Englishman that brought about the Nome strike, not his success. The Englishman in question was Cyrus Field. As a young man, Field dreamed of building a transatlantic cable for telegraphic communication that would link Europe with America. Further, he envisioned a worldwide cable system where messages would speed along wires strung across land and laid on the bottom of the seas. A successful merchant, he retired at 33 and formed the New York, Newfoundland, and London Telegraph Company. After three failed expeditions, he was able to lay a working cable between England and Ireland in 1858. Then, in 1866, after the American Civil War, he successfully laid the first transatlantic cable. But even as Field was laying his submarine cable, his competitors saw an opportunity for themselves. While the undersea cable across the Atlantic was certainly an admirable idea, it was still a very expensive proposition. A more economic idea was a landline linking the cities of the world. Whether Field succeeded or failed, there was still going to be a need for a spiderweb of telegraphic wires on land to link the world's cities. Realizing that a less expensive means of running a telegraph cable from North America to Europe would be across Siberia and under the narrow waters of the Bering Strait, Western Union raised money to link North America with Asia. One member of the expedition to lay the cable was a 22-year-old Civil War veteran by the name of Daniel B. Libby. On September 16, 1866, Libby and a Western Union construction crew of 40 men landed at Port Clarence, 100 miles north of Nome, and spent the next 10 months stretching wire along 23 miles of the Seward Peninsula. Then came a brutal winter. Not that there are any other kind in the Arctic. The expedition had not packed properly, and by April, months before the mantle of ice broke on the Bering Sea, the small party ran out of food. Facing imminent starvation, Libby stopped work on the telegraph and sent his men out, individually and in different directions, to forage for food. It was with great difficulty that they got enough to eat, Libby said of his men, and it was no small blessing when the supply ship arrived on June 28, 1867. But there was bad news aboard. Cyrus Field had succeeded in laying the cable under the Atlantic, and Western Union was abandoning its Trans-Siberian project. On July 2, 1867, the Libby party, less two men who had been interred beneath the frozen sod, departed. But the winter on the Seward Peninsula had not been without some promise. Libby had seen unmistakable evidence of gold. For the next 30 years, he talked of going back and searching for the elusive yellow metal. Then, in 1897, when the story of the Klondike strike captured the imagination of the world, Libby set about organizing an expedition north. He had no trouble finding partners, and on August 18, 1897, Libby and three partners left San Francisco for Port Clarence, with enough supplies to last the four-man party for several years. Libby clearly was not going to face starvation again. By July of 1898, the men had struck it rich. With the success of the Libby party, there was an undistinguished rush that led to the formation of a miners' district and community of Council City, a handful of miles from where Nome is today. It was on his way to this remote outpost of civilization that one of the so-called three lucky Swedes made the discovery that established Nome. Erik Lindblom, a Swedish tailor, jumped ship at a small native village on his way to Kotzebue and hid out with a family of Eskimos until his ship gave up searching for him. Hitching a ride with his host to Council City, Lindblom made the first discovery on the future site of Nome when the Eskimos stopped at the mouth of the Snake River to fish. Lindblom returned to the spot in August of 1898 with two partners, Jafet Lindberg and John Brinteson, and made the strike that made history. Thereafter, the history of Nome was one of boom. It wasn't a city that grew or a community that bloomed from the tundra overnight. Nome erupted into maturity. One moment it was a deserted stretch of Alaskan coastline on the Norton Sound. The next it was so white with tents set peg to peg that the landscape appeared to be snow-covered. And it was one of the most desolate places on Earth. Located 2,300 miles north of Seattle, the strike was on treeless, flat country that saw fewer than 120 days a year of ice-free ocean for steamship travel, June 1st to October 1st. In addition to its desolation and climatic conditions, it had no harbor, and the water off the coast was so shallow that ships could not approach closer than a mile from shore. Everything had to come ashore on shallow draft barges and small boats. During the winter, there were months of unbroken frigid weather, accented by ferocious snowstorms, whiteouts, and very short daylight hours around the winter solstice. During the summer, it was a strip of beach sand immediately adjacent to an unending, low, flat swamp that teemed with every kind of biting, sucking, stinging, swarming insect. Travel across the tundra was circuitous where possible, and unless there was a wind blowing, a man could be driven mad by the sheer number of insects descending upon him. It was also the least likely place to find gold. There were no nearby mountains from which gold veins could drop nuggets into a river system. The land was ancient in geologic terms, and the rivers that did exist were so sluggish that they could not be used for sluicing. Nome had a tide of 2 feet, and during the winter the ocean was covered with an ice plate that stretched all the way to Siberia. During the winter, the ground froze solid to the permafrost, making mining virtually impossible. Even the naming of the area was unusual. It began a half a century before the Alaska Gold Rush, when a British mariner from a rescue mission identified the cape on which Nome is now located with the handwritten notation, ?name. Back in London, a cartographer misread the scribbling as Sea Nome, or Cape Nome. Other sources contend that Nome was a corruption of the Yupik expression, "Kane no me," which translates as "I don't know" or "I don't understand." The initial beneficiaries of the gold in the area were known as the Three Lucky Swedes, and it did not take long for greed to set in among the other stampeders. Recognizing that it would be easier to jump good claims than look for gold on their own, a mass meeting was called to declare all claims in the area null, and thus open them up for restaking. So sure were the perpetrators that this scheme would work, wood for bonfires was piled in strategic locations so that once the ruling was made that the claims were voided, bonfires could be kindled so men in the field could rush in and stake the best claims for themselves and their partners in town. It was a bold scheme that might have worked except for a handful of soldiers who broke up the meeting. But the handful of soldiers could not hold off popular sentiment long, and it was the accidental discovery of gold on the beaches that turned Nome from a seething cauldron of discontent to a town where everyone who could find a pot, pan, or cradle was on the beach panning for gold. And since no one can own tidelands, they were open to all. With the discovery of gold on Nome's beach, which was in the public domain, the strike changed from one of large mining operations squeezing out smaller ones to a poor man's paradise. Some of the claims on the beach were as small as 16 square feet, but they were yielding $1,000 a square foot, or, as stampeder Robert Easton estimated, $256,000 from a piece of ground no larger than your living room floor. That's about $4 million today. When it came to beach property, you owned the land you were standing on, wrote one stampeder, but you lost your right to it the minute you left. All manner of equipment and inventions were used. While most of the miners worked with traditional pans, sluices, and rockers, there were some bizarre contraptions as well. Several companies experimented with a caisson, or shallow water rig. At least one of them was 16 feet long and 4 feet wide and high. At low tide, the caisson was rolled out 120 feet into the surf, where it sucked up sand from the bottom of Norton Sound and ran it through a sluice system. That operation was fairly successful and netted about $6 for every shovelful of sand that came through the sluice. It was estimated in today's dollars that Nome's first year produced $64 million in gold, half of it from off the beaches. Numerous miners were making between $160,000 and $320,000. Scores made between $50,000 and $128,000, while hundreds were making between $24,000 to $32,000. When gold was discovered on the beaches, men were making between $320,000 and $16,000 per day, and spending $600 a day of it in the saloons and gambling houses. It was the discovery of the gold on the beaches that turned Nome from a city of destitute Argonauts to a boomtown. There was gold on the beaches, and it was just a matter of picking it up. The simplicity with which the gold could be taken immediately generated a double rush, one down the Yukon River from Dawson and the other by steamship from the Pacific Northwest. Every ship in Dawson that could be loaded with passengers was rushing to Nome. By the fall of 1899, Nome wasn't a town. It was a landing zone. Argonauts were coming into the city so fast there was no place to house them. Carl Lohman, later to become one of the most respected men in the area, recalled that the confusion was appalling. Machinery, hay and grain, hardware, provisions, liquor, tents, pianos, mirrors, bar fixtures, household furniture were all stored in the open. Stovepipes were everywhere, all breathing out a slow black smoke that settled in a dark fog over everything, biting at a man's throat and making his nose run. Cargo from incoming ships was lost overboard and washed up on shore, where it was snatched by whoever happened to be nearby. In town, claims to town lots were jumped. The cabins that had been erected were hauled away at night by horses brought by gangs of men, some of the owners still in the cabins. and before they could get back to their location, another structure would be occupying the ground. When one stampeder arrived in Nome, he recalled that the horizon was white with tents, with the dark silhouettes of buildings which could be seen among the tents, which spread back for miles on the tundra in great white blobs. In the history of gold rushes, Nome was unique. Access to the gold-bearing sands was simply a matter of buying a steamship ticket. It did not require any particular stamina to reach the gold fields. While the Argonauts on their way to the Klondike over the Chilkoot Trail were moving ahead at the rate of 50 pounds at a time, in Nome it was simply a matter of being barged ashore with your supplies. This led to an entirely different breed of Argonaut. Anyone from a lounge lizard to a bank president could be a miner. All it took was finding a vacant space on the beach after the tide came in. No one owned any property, so there was no expense to get into the mining business. All it took was a willingness to put up with hardships. By September of 1899, the Revenue Cutter Service estimated there were between 2,000 and 3,000 residents of Nome, with another 1,000 expected to arrive from Dawson. About 2,000 were expected to leave Nome before the ice came in, but Nome would still have to accommodate about 2,500 people all winter long, with very limited building accommodations and a great lack of fuel. Food supplies were estimated at 1,700 tons for the next 6 months. The Revenue Cutter Service did its part to alleviate part of the problem. They illegally seized a number of known malcontents, most of them with criminal records in the lower states, and gave them a blue ticket. In Alaskanese, a blue ticket is a one-way ticket out of town on the first available means of transportation in any direction. Blue tickets were being regularly used as late as 1905. With so many Argonauts and so few supplies and services, prices were jumping stiff-legged, as one Argonaut wrote. Prices in Nome were astronomical compared to Seattle. In today's dollars, meals in Nome ranged from $40 to $80 depending on the quality. A bed in a tent was $24. Drinks were $8 for beer. Some items, such as the copper plate used in the gold rockers, were going for its weight in gold. If copper couldn't be bought, other metals were substituted. One miner even used 64 silver dollars to plate his rocker. With so much gold and so little law and order, it was only a matter of time before corruption would set in. But no one expected corruption to be on the scale in which it came. In chaos, there is profit, and no one understood this better than one of the most powerful political bosses in the United States in 1899, Alexander Mackenzie. As the Republican National Committee man from North Dakota, he had controlled politics in his state for more than two decades and had tremendous influence in Washington, D.C. The possibility of reaping great personal rewards in Nome came to Mackenzie's attention when he was approached by Oliver P. Hubbard of the Nome law firm of Hubbard, Beeman, and Hume, the firm who was representing the Argonauts intent on jumping all claims filed by the three lucky Swedes. Mackenzie immediately saw the possibility of a scam beyond even his wildest imagination and arranged to have a corrupt judge, Alfred Noyes, appointed to the Nome seat. Mackenzie and Noyes came to Nome in July of 1900 and proceeded to legally seize every rich claim they could lay their hands on. Stating that they were only holding the gold until a judicial decision could be reached, they legally seized $16 million in today's dollars and waited to catch the last boat out of Nome. They were only stopped at the last minute by a ruling from a San Francisco judge that arrived on the very ship which Mackenzie and Noyes expected to depart with their booty. It was a close call, and it was only the concerted action by the lawyers of Nome that stalled what amounted to blatant theft by duly appointed legal officers. The citizens of Fairbanks should have been so lucky. Fairbanks, like Juneau and Nome, was founded by accident. In August of 1901, Elbridge Truman Barnett convinced a gullible steamboat captain that his ship could easily ascend the Tananore River without striking bottom. However, when it became apparent that Barnett did not know what he was talking about, the steamboat captain angrily evicted the protesting Barnett along with 135 tons of his supplies onto the nearest shore, which happened to be on the Chena Slough. As Barnett's supplies were being offloaded, a sourdough by the name of Felix Pedro suddenly appeared on the bank. He had a major find in the area and was wondering if Barnett would have any food to sell, since he, Pedro, did not want to walk the 360 miles round trip to Circle for supplies. Then and there was established Chenoa City, later to become known as Fairbanks. Barnett, ever the entrepreneur, was not about to let his location, quite literally in the middle of nowhere, stop him from making his fortune. The first winter, he traded for furs from local Indians and prospectors and took the pelts to the lower states where he and wife Isabel spent the winter. The next spring, he and his wife returned with a new steamship, the Isabel, with a very shallow draft that he had sent in pieces to St. Michael at the mouth of the Yukon River. It was there that he met and conversed with United States Judge James Wickersham of the 3rd District and changed the map of Alaska. At that time, Wickersham's court was in Eagle, a community that was diminishing in population. Wickersham had a judicial district that was about 300,000 square miles in size, larger than the state of Texas, and he wanted to move his court to a different community. But he had a problem. Other communities wanted an exorbitant price for land, and money was in short supply with the federal government. Barnett offered Wickersham a free lot on which to establish his court, which was no particular problem for Barnett, as it would cost him nothing to make the offer. But then again, his wasn't much of a town. Wickersham suggested that Barnett rename his city Fairbanks in honor of Senator Charles Warren Fairbanks from Indiana, the man who had made Wickersham's appointment to judge possible. Barnett, not one to pass up a chit when it cost him nothing, agreed. Both men probably left the meeting assuming that they had not agreed to anything. Wickersham couldn't move his court to a flyspeck of civilization even if the land was free, and Barnett's renaming of a few cabins in honor of a senator who would never come to Alaska was an empty gesture at best. History had a little surprise for both of them. In April of 1902, while Barnett was outside, his brother-in-law, Frank Cleary, was operating his general store. Cleary had been given specific instructions not to give any goods or supplies to anyone wanting credit, and particularly prospectors like Felix Pedro, who was broke. But when Pedro came to the cash, he was able to talk Cleary into giving him a season of supplies against $100 cash. Cleary took the money and put the rest on account. While Cleary was undoubtedly wondering what he was going to tell Barnett when he returned, Pedro made a dazzling discovery less than 12 miles from the general store. At first, he tried to keep it a secret, but it leaked and there was a general rush into the area. By the time Barnett returned to his cache on September 8th, the first news he heard was of Pedro's strike. The crew of the Isabel immediately quit their jobs and began staking the nearby creeks. Barnett was not slow in taking advantage of this flash of fortune and staked for himself, his wife, and a half dozen relatives in Ohio whose power of attorney he had acquired earlier. 2 days later, a miners' meeting was held in Felix Pedro's tent. A new mining district was voted into existence with Barnett as its recorder. When Barnett suggested the name of the community to be formed be called Fairbanks, no one objected. Thus was Fairbanks officially named. But it was still not a city. It had no people. Basically, Fairbanks was nothing more than a few cabins and a seat of a mining district, the last being simply a political designation. But Barnett was not above a little more chicanery. A gold rush into the area would give the population base a budge, so he sent his cook, Jujira Wada, to Dawson to spin the tale of the gold of Felix Pedro's discovery to draw people to Fairbanks. Spin one he did, for Wada was no fool. He did such an admirable job that he was able to get front page coverage for this new strike, possibly as big as the Klondike. The story made the front page of the Yukon Sun on January 17, 1903, and as many as 1,000 men hit the trail for Fairbanks. Considering it was the middle of winter, with the mercury at 74 below in some places, this rush was a dangerous undertaking at best. Some of the entrepreneurs in Dawson were concerned enough about the alleged strike in the Tanana Valley to do some investigating on their own. A strike that close to Dawson could put them out of business. If there really was a strike, it might be in their best interest to set up subsidiary businesses in Fairbanks. But before they made the move, they needed to know if there was really a strike in the vicinity of Barnett's cache. Pooling their resources, they sent a respected mining operator, James Coatless Monroe, also known as Curly, to investigate the claims made by Fairbanks. Coatless had earned his nickname by never wearing a parka or gloves, no matter how cold it got. Coatless made it to Fairbanks, and on his return in March 1903, he reported that the only money in circulation was that from the rushers' pockets. While there might be a strike in the Tanana Valley someday, that day was not in 1903. But Coatless wasn't saying anything the locals didn't know. Rather than making living conditions better, the discovery of gold had made them worse. They couldn't mine during the winter, and there wasn't a job to be had. A local by the name of Ford was quoted in the Alaska Forum as stating that in terms of gold, $20 will cover the entire output in Fairbanks that winter, and that was the poorest excuse for a foundation to base a stampede on I ever saw. It didn't take long for the rushers to realize they had been bamboozled. When they got to the Fairbanks area, they found no gold, primarily because it was winter and mining was difficult to perform. The lack of a boom, understandably, led to ill will, particularly as Barnett's was the only store in the area and his prices were sky high. Particularly galling was his requirement that every man buying a bag of flour for $250 in today's dollars also had to buy 3 cases of canned goods, which some men claimed were spoiled. Tensions were running high. The rush had happened in the dead of winter, meaning that men had put their lives on the line to make it to the Tanana. Once in the fabled valley, all they found was snow, unemployment, high prices, and too many men competing for what jobs there were. At first, the anger of the newcomers focused on the man who had lured them west, Jujiro Wada. It did not take long before the miners held a mass meeting to decide what to do. No one appeared interested in eating horse or dog, as one miner recalled, and Barnett's prices were too high for many of the men to eat bread. Since talking about their problems did not resolve the matter, a mob was formed and Wada was grabbed and dragged before the council. Wada, terrified that he would be lynched, didn't give the mob enough satisfaction, so they went looking for Barnett with a nicely noosed rope. They found him exactly where they expected him, at his store. But he was flanked by a dozen men, each carrying a high-powered rifle. There was a brief verbal confrontation, and a compromise was reached. For Barnett's part, he cut the price of flour in half and did not require the acquisition of a case of canned goods with the flour. Shortly thereafter, Barnett headed out for the winter. This eased tensions considerably. But there was indeed gold in the area, and Fairbanks did grow. But it was a wild city, a rollicking town, the kind that no Hollywood producer need invent for the screen. No less a character than Swiftwater Bill Gates of Dawson, who certainly knew saloons, said of Fairbanks that it was only one sidewalk. If you fall off one side, you fall into the mud. If you fall off the other, you fall into a saloon. The railroad came, and soon Fairbanks was a transportation and cargo hub for the Alaskan interior. Barnett's stature grew as well, and it was not long before he established one of the first banks in the city, the Washington Alaska Bank. It proved to be a very profitable venture until January of 1911, when Barnett fled town with the bank's treasury, an estimated $10.5 million in today's dollars. He was eventually arrested in Los Angeles and brought back to trial in Valdez. But with the best legal assistance money could buy, he was found guilty of only one charge, a misdemeanor. The judge fined him $1,000. Barnett paid the fine and left Alaska. The Fairbanks Daily News Miner called the trial the rottenest judicial farce the North has ever witnessed, and for years used the term Barnett as the verb to rob. There has long been debate as to how much money Barnett might have stolen. It was clear to his 1,400 depositors that Barnett had absconded with their money, 5,600 ounces of it, which was seized in Cordova as it was being shipped out of Alaska, that the number was substantially high enough for Barnett to live comfortably for many years to come. He did. As late as 1920, Barnett still owned a palatial estate in Mexico. Thereafter, he disappears from the historical record. All that is known for certain is that Barnett died in the abyss of obscurity. When he died accidentally of a fall in his home in Los Angeles on May 22, 1933, his passing was not even recorded by the Alaskan papers. No history of the Alaska Gold Rush would be complete without revealing the human face of the era. No collection of people is truly a community until it has the amenities of civilization, chief of them being an operating newspaper. Single sheet, tabloid, or daily, the press is the heartbeat of the town. Nothing is news until it's in the press. Then it's history. The Alaska Gold Rush spawned hundreds of newspapers, many of which lasted only a few issues. Many did not make it that long. They appeared like lonely crusaders on milk-white stallions, armed to do battle with the forces of evil. Usually represented by corrupt businesses, sniveling government officials, petty bureaucrats, and, when no other target was available, other newspapers. Today, less than a handful remain. It is important to note that newspapers were far more influential in the Alaska Gold Rush than in any other part of the country. Unlike the rest of the nation, Alaskans did not have the option of being able to speak frequently with neighbors from the next town. In Alaska, there were no next towns. As a result, news items from each community were often reprinted in other papers so that anyone reading a paper would get a snippet of news from Nome, Juneau, Valdez, Kodiak, or Fairbanks. Just as important, news organizations produced leaders. Four of Alaska's appointed governors were newspapermen: Alfred P. Swineford, John F. A. Strong, Scott Bone, and John Troy, and several others had newspaper experience outside of Alaska. But running a newspaper in Alaska was like trying to drink tea on the subway. Many of Alaska's early papers were the product of small printing presses that could be carried in a rucksack and set up in a tent. Using a cabin, even temporarily, was an improvement. Sometimes the sheets were typewritten or run through hand-fed printers, much like a medieval printing press. Perhaps the most expensive newspaper in the history of Alaska was hand-typed by James Wickersham. To finance his Mount McKinley expedition, Wickersham typed the May 9, 1903 edition of the Fairbanks Miner and sold the copies, all seven of them, for $125 in 1990. It was 8 pages in length, using every sheet of legal paper that was in Fairbanks that day. No chapter on newspapers in Alaska would be complete without a section on the most sued member of the press, George Hinton Henry. Henry published 6 papers in 4 cities between 1907 and 1915, all of them going broke, and he probably holds the record for the number of times an editor has been sued for slander, though the true number is unknown, as most of the records for that period have been lost. His most celebrated journalistic target was Commissioner Henry Bathurst of Hot Springs. In those days, the commissioner was the only local representative of law and order. Bathurst had filed 5 indictments against Henry, but none of them had stopped the editor from sniping. Finally, Henry went one editorial too far, and Bathurst sentenced him to 90 days in jail. Not to be outdone, Henry got a tramp printer to continue to publish his paper, which continued to criticize Bathurst while he, Henry, was in jail. Bathurst then issued a warrant for the arrest of the press and had it installed in the cell next to Henry. When Henry was released, the press was not. Henry left town, and eventually the press was tossed onto a garbage heap. Years later, in 1923, Judge James Wickersham rescued it and sent it to the University of Alaska Fairbanks. It should also be pointed out that the bulk of the Argonauts were men. This does not mean that there were no women present. Even excluding the dance hall girls, there were more than a handful of women who came north, many of them alone. A stampede might not have been the most proper place for a woman in those days, but this did not deter all of them. Fanny Quigley made a living cooking for the stampeders. Whenever there was a new strike, Fanny would hitch up her cooking wares and hike to the next boom, thus her nickname, Fanny the Hike. Today, Fanny is memorialized as the driving force behind the formation of Denali National Park, the most visited tourist attraction in Alaska. Sinrock Mary, an Eskimo, was the richest woman in Alaska. Her wealth was in reindeer, many of which she sold to the stampeders in Nome. Women also held jobs as cooks, postmasters, and secretaries, and many worked alongside men in the gold fields. The Alaska Gold Rush was not a white man's strike either. Felix Pedro, who discovered the gold that made Fairbanks, was Italian. The three lucky Swedes in Nome, only two of whom were Swedish, were naturalized citizens, and the man responsible for the Juneau boom was an Auk Indian, Chief Cowie. Non-native women and minorities made up about one quarter of the total population of Argonauts. One of the sad facts of the Alaska Gold Rush was that while the big winners were the stampeders who struck it rich, the big losers were the natives. Little thought was given to the rights, status, or privileges of Alaska's indigenous people, and they were trampled whenever and wherever the Argonauts stampeded. This is not to say that no one cared for the rights of the natives. This would be inaccurate. Many people fought to protect the rights of the natives, but they were in the minority, and until the Argonauts left, the natives were often left to starve, their natural sources of food depleted by rushing hordes of miners. Not a lot of the Argonauts of 98 ever became wealthy. Of the 100,000 Argonauts, only a few hundred ever came home with enough gold to call themselves wealthy. But all came home changed by the grandeur of Alaska. From San Francisco to Paris to Moscow, the returning stampeders talked of the walrus and grizzly, the Eskimo, and bellying up to the bar with Wyatt Earp. Madison Square Garden had its roots in the Alaska Gold Rush, as do Boca Raton, Florida, and the Guggenheim Art Gallery. An entire century after the madness swept the world, the works of Jack London, Robert Service, and Rex Beach can still be found in bookstores. Hollywood continues to reach into the Alaska Gold Rush, for the stories continue to astound us. And north, the tourists still come, by the millions, to the land made famous by gold. In terms of perspective, the total gold output for all of Alaska from 1880 to 1906, 26 years, was $2.1 billion in today's dollars. In 1995 alone, Alaska saw an economic impact of $1.7 billion from the tourism business alone, many of them coming north to see the land made by the Alaska Gold Rush. Tourism has become the new Alaska Gold Rush. Is the Alaska Gold Rush over? Well, it's all a matter of perspective.